Well, hello there. Welcome, 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 welcome to On the Move with Joanna Ward. I am she, and we have some great exercises, information, and encouragement for you today. So you want to get fit, right? But you just don't know where to start? That's what we're going to work on today. We're going to work on the arms, the arms, the arms, the abs. They're a system that works together to build you up from the inside, right here and out. So before we get started with that, we're gonna do a warm-up. A warm muscle is always gonna burn more fat, it's gonna be leaner, it's gonna be longer, and it's gonna work much harder when it's warm. So let's get started with the workout. Let's spread our legs nice and wide, and let's start to rock back and forth. Good job. Yeah, that's right. We're just gonna go side to side. You can use my music or you can use your own. We're gonna do this four more times, and we're gonna stretch our arms. Three. Two, and one. Let's stretch it out here, side to side. And what I'm doing is I'm warming up my arms and my waist, hips and thighs at the same time. Still breathing. Good job. Four more sets, we're gonna take this forward. Three, two, one, take it forward. Yeah. Bet you didn't know something this simple could warm your body up. Do it a little bit, I promise you it'll work. Four more sets, we're gonna add the legs. Two, and one, step side to side. Tap, and stand, step, stand, step, stand. Squeeze, breathe. Real simple. We just wanna do a light warm up. Four more, we're gonna double it up. Three, and what I mean, instead of tapping once, we're gonna do it twice right here. And twice on this side. Good. Most important thing is to get moving. You're on the move with Joanna Ward. So let's do it. Don't just stand there and watch me. Get up and do something. We're gonna do four more. We're going back to that wide stance. Three, and we're gonna warm up the hamstring and the quads. One more set. Take that wide stance, curl, curl, quads and hands, okay? Good. Just like so. If you can touch your hand with your heel, that's even better. If not, this is fine too. But try to get it up. We want the entire body warm, okay? Four more sets. And we're gonna do the knee lifts, okay? Three, where you at? Two. Let's make this the last curls. We're gonna do knee lifts here. Up, up. Try to get higher than your waist, okay? Here's your waist. Try to make your knee go higher. Remember, this is just the warm-up. Good job. We're gonna do four more sets here. Four, three, two, one. Now we're gonna march it out. And because we're getting ready to do a series of arms, we're gonna make sure that we roll those out first. Big wide circles forward. Breathing. Forward, forward, forward. Now we're gonna take it back, back. Perfect. Three more. Two more. One more. Good job. We're gonna hold it back here together. If you can, that's fine. If not, just reach as much as you can. But if you can grab your hands and flex out, that's perfect. We're still taking those deep breaths. Should be nice and warm now. We're gonna take the same arms forward. We're gonna wrap that left and take it across to the right and put the chin on the shoulder. I know, you feel like you worked out already. That was just a warm-up though. And take it here. Now, I wanna let you know that it doesn't matter how much you work out or what you do, it's gonna take some commitment and consistency. And let's warm up the triceps here. But more importantly, it's gonna be connected with what you eat. And what I mean by that is the effectiveness of your workout, regardless of what it is you commit to, is only gonna be as powerful and effective as what you fuel it with. Your fitness has to be fueled, it has to be fed, and it has to be more than just what you put in your mouth, okay? So let's stretch your legs a little bit. We're gonna take a nice wide stance, rock side to side. Loosen up the hamstrings, the quads. We're gonna take it down slowly and put our palms down if you can. If you can't put your palms down, maybe you can reach your legs here or stay here, but ultimately this is your goal. And let's hold it over to the right Perfect. And let's walk it back over to the left. And hold. Good job. And let's take it back center. Now we're going to take this back up. We're going to walk it in. We're going to rotate the ankle here. And take that quad back. Trying to pull that heel to the glute. Working on our balance, okay? Good job. Let's do the same thing on this side. Rolling the ankle here. And let's try to bring this up here. And hold. Perfect. Okay, so if you have weights, we're getting ready to grab those. If you don't have weights, you can use shoes, water bottles, canned goods, or just use nothing, just use your arms. But I prefer to use weights because I don't like lifting like really, really heavy weights, so I try to use no more than 10-pound weights in a various series, which is what we're gonna do. So if you have 2 pounds all the way to 10, some people use 15 and 20. Me personally, I try to cap it off at 10. So I'm gonna grab those. I'm gonna take a wide stance, and I'm gonna do bicep curls. I'm gonna swing from shoulder to shoulder here and bring it back down and then to this shoulder. I'm just gonna graze it. Again, demonstration, here, go, go. Okay, so I got a little bit more speed, but you don't have to go fast. Here's what you can do. You can put your timer on your phone, 30 seconds. Once that's too easy, go to 60 and then 90. Or if you wanna do sets, start with 30. Go to 50, and then go however high you wanna go. But start where you are, do what you can, and use what you have, okay? The biggest part of fitness is motion and getting it done. People are always asking, can you do me a fitness program? Can you do me a meal program? I can, but you have to be willing before you're able to actually put those things into action, okay? So you're gonna keep swinging here. Again, I'm touching. These are 10-pound weights. What am I working in? Biceps? I'm trying to get in a little cross action in my midsection as well while I'm standing here, okay? Working on my full range of motion by meeting those shoulders. I'm gonna do 4 more singles. Now what we're gonna do is we're gonna do the doubles, okay? This is gonna take a little bit more of the system as opposed to just the biceps. I'm gonna have to go here using my abs and my back, come back down center, and then here, all right? So a little bit more motion in the whole entire system between my arms and my abs, okay? I'm gonna go to right first. Right, left, down, right. Perfect. How you doing? Now, if these were to get too heavy, I could drop one, swing, swing. Still going over the shoulder, adding a little bit more twisting here. Looking back here, going over. I'm gonna pick mine back up, because I actually like to use the weight. Swing it to the right, swing it to the left. Right, left. And I'm isolating the waist, okay? Hips are isolated. I'm not going here and coming off balance. I want the toning. The definition to stay streamlined in the middle. And I'm letting these arms do the work of sculpting. I'm nice and warm, you should be nice and warm. Swing it over the shoulder. 8 more. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, and this is gonna be a last set. All right. You should feel like a She-Ra or a He-Man after that. So let's shake it off. Perfect. Again, that was a cross-center bicep motion with the shoulders angling at the upper torso, okay? So we're gonna do now is shoulder presses. We're gonna come out of shoulder presses into a chest press. So the shoulder presses are gonna be here. We're gonna keep this wide base stance. Bring our weights together, take it down. Back even with the shoulders, together, back down. Once we finish that set, we're gonna come in for the chest press. Now, what is this working? Pecs, shoulders, traps. In a very simple way, right in your living room, okay? It's not that you need to go to the gym, it's just you need to get going, okay? Let's grab our weights. Oh, I need to go to the gym. No, just get going, okay? So pick up what you have or just your arms, and we're gonna go up. So technique of touch, and then rest. Stop right here, don't stop down here. There's a place to do that and time to do that, but that's not what we're doing right now. We're gonna stop here, and we're gonna press up. Take it down, good job. And you're breathing. There's no arch in your back, everything is straight. Here, and stop at your shoulders. Touch those waists overhead, stop at your shoulders. Touch, and drop. Touch, and stop, okay? 8, perfect. 7, stay with me, don't give up, don't give up. 6. You got this. 5. Come on, come on. 4. Come on, keep going. 3 more. Here's your last 2. Now let me ask you something. Can you go straight to the chest press after this? Let's try it. Here we go. Press. And back to that spot. Press. It's okay if you had to take a break. Just join me when you can. Good job. Take it in and out. Take it in and out. Good job. If your elbows can touch, that's great. If not, hey, get where you can. Just come back out here. Let's do 8 more. Perfect. 7. Good job. 6. Keep going. Last 5. I know it burns. 4. But that's the way your muscles learn. 3. Good job. 2. 1 more. And 1. Now you can put whatever you're working with down. Okay, good job. All right. So that was a combination of shoulder presses, chest presses. Let's shake that out. Let's stretch that out. Let's go back to our original stretch here. Taking a deep breath. Good job. Let's roll those hands. Let's take it across again. We have one more arm exercise I'm going to show you before we go to break, okay? Rotate those wrists. And this is a delt. I love these. And I kind of like hulk up and then I squeeze down. I hulk up and I squeeze down. So even if you don't have any weights, just kind of like feel like you're a big bad person or big bad person, workout person, not in reality, in character, but just in motion. And just go, ah, and then exhale. Inhale, and then exhale. So kind of turn into a green man and hell of an incredible Hulk, and then relax everything down. Okay? Let's go ahead and do that. So we're gonna bend slightly on our knees, have those weights here, and we're gonna hulk up and press down. Lift and squeeze. Even if you make me in the face, oh, even if you don't have 10 pounds, just pretend, fake it until you make it. Okay? Guess what you're doing? You're lifting those obliques, those shoulders, toning them, strengthening your back, your heart, your lungs, your kidneys. Good job. Take it up. Release. 8 more. You got this. 7. Come on. 6. Way to work. 5. Come on. 4. Don't give up just because your muscles want you to. Last 3. 2. You know what I want to do? After this one, let's pump for 8. Give me 8. 7. Come on. 6. 5. You got it. 4. 3. 2. And 1. Oh, doesn't that feel wonderful? So that was our serious series of arm work. As you notice, it didn't take us that long, but I'm pretty sure that you feel like you did a lot. But it's that consistency and that persistency that births what it is that you really not just want, but need from your body. You see, the thing about your body and exercise, you see the sweat on me? You take a bath when you get dirty, you've been at work all day, you feel kind of grimy. You're like, let me go take a bath. Well, every time you exercise, you get your heart rate up and you do what we just did, it's a bath for your body. So you earn this type of sweat. It doesn't come naturally. You gotta put the work in. Hey, so are you really working and washing your body from the inside out? Scrubbing the bubbles, the heart, the lung, the kidneys, and all that wonderful stuff. The only way you can work those things out and clean them out is by working out. We can ready to take a break. I'll be right back. Welcome back. Welcome back. Welcome back. I hope that you enjoyed that bath for the inner parts of your body. And so I want to talk to you today about the inner parts of your body. And typically I call your body a box. That's right. This right here is a box that contains not just the organs that keep you alive and healthy every day, but it contains your heart, your spiritual heart, your mind, your soul, and your entire being. The things that will translate and transition once this box of body goes into the box that we put 6 feet under when we leave this earth. And with those things in mind, we just did a bath for our bodies. We just sweated, hopefully you sweated, and you worked some things out. Where there's some things within those parts of our spirit, our soul, our hearts, and our minds that need to be worked out as well. And there's only one way to do that. People seek it through alcohol, drugs, relationships. They seek it through being vengeful and spiteful and mean towards other people and yet go unfulfilled. But David, the psalmist, says in Psalms 23, he restores my soul. Who is he talking about? He's talking about the Lord. He's talking about the Lord being a good shepherd, a shepherd that goes deeper than giving you a house, a spouse, a car, and a career, and everything that the world shows you that you should really, really want and desire. His will is, though, that we be healthy in our hearts. And so I want to talk to you about taking a bath for your heart and how to get help for that. There's healing. There's healing at the spiritual level for your entire body. And the heart is not just the heart that's beating in your chest. There's a spiritual part of your heart. It contains all of your emotions, all of your thoughts, all your motives. Everything that you desire, everything that you think you love is arrived and it thrives and it built from the inside of your spiritual heart. An example of this is given to us in 1 Samuel chapter 25. And at this point, King David is displaced from his army. He's in the wilderness and he's running around and he's roaming around, and he knew that he was anointed from the time that Samuel called him out of that pasture. He knew that he was anointed from the time that he killed and slayed Goliath. He knew it. He'd experienced God's grace, his mercy, his favor, and everything. But yet, by the time we get to 1 Samuel chapter 25, David and his men, the few that follow him, they're out, they're weary, they're hungry, they're tired. And they go to someone that they had helped in the past named Nabal. And Nabal's name means fool. But he wasn't too foolish. He got a wife called Abigail. Abigail was a beautiful and wise woman. And David sends a message to Nabal, asking Nabal for some help. Just give us some food. And Nabal says this: you're not popular. You're not prosperous. You don't have a doctor's degree. I mean, I know, David, you helped me, but look at you now. You're kind of displaced. Nobody likes you. You're roaming around. But what Nabal forgot is David was anointed. And I know you're saying, where does this story have to do with the heart? I'm getting ready to tell you. Because Nabal was a greedy, selfish, but yet wealthy man. He didn't have the heart to help David. And David was not just a worshiper. David was a warrior. So when the messenger came back and told David that Nabal said, David, go kick rocks, David said, tomorrow I'm going to kill everyone in Nabal's house. And here's what happened. And here's the difference between two hearts. This is the tale of two hearts. One woman that becomes both men's wives. David shows up and Abigail meets him halfway. And she says, my husband is a fool and we apologize. And she gives David rice and she gives him raisins and meat. And she says, please spare us, David, because you're a wealthy man already. You may not have it, but God's blessed you and he's going to continue to bless you and you're going to be a king. And she exalts David, and David is able to hear because David has a heart that belongs to God. And he's listening to Abigail, his adversary's wife, and he hears and he hearkens to her voice. And she tells him, she said, don't put innocent people's blood on your hands, David. You're a blessed man. And he hears that. He gets all the gifts that she gives him, and he goes about his way. And Abigail goes back, kind of furious with her husband named Nabal the fool, and he's in a drunken rage, having a party, gloating off being a glutton off his greed. And she waits until he's sober. And she tells him, I gave David just a little bit of your stuff. And upon hearing this, because of what was in Nabal's heart, he has a heart attack. A heart attack because of what he heard. He didn't have any proof. He never saw it. She just said it. But it hit him in the heart because he was greedy and selfish, and he couldn't hear righteousness and righteously. He had a heart attack, and he was stretched out, the Bible says, go read it, 1 Samuel 25, for 10 days. And it says, not David, but God struck Nabal with death. And this is a tale of two hearts. And it tells us a lot about what we hear and what we listen to and what we eat through our ears. And not just that, but how it affects our hearts, how it affects the outcomes of our lives. And so I challenge and encourage you today to check the climate of your heart. I'm not going to tell you that anything's wrong or bad about bitterness, unforgiveness, jealousy, hatred, being hard on yourself about things in life that you couldn't even change or help. Life is going to live life on its own terms. You can only control a certain amount in your own life. You definitely can't control life. But that is not a time or place for you to harbor bitterness, anger, resentment, jealousy, discord, or anything other than God's love, his joy, his peace, and his tranquility in your heart. And many people say, Joanna, well, how do I change that? I thought that was human nature. It is human nature. But by the blood of the Lamb, hallelujah, and by the word of this testimony that I'm giving you today, the blood of Jesus Christ can change the blood that's pumping through your heart. The blood that's in your heart spiritually shouldn't be hatred. It shouldn't be anxiety. It should definitely not be fear. That is, those are weapons of the enemy of your entire soul. And if you can get in your heart and create that climate, it becomes cancerous. It becomes sick. And that sickness and that cancer and that dis-ease will affect every outcome in your life, just like it did Nabal. And if you know David's story, while it's very tumultuous, and he goes from the pasture to the palace with a great deal of stress and struggle and trauma and tragedy, and all these things meet David. But David's heart is always in the right place. Even when he meets Bathsheba, he does error, adultery, as a matter of fact. And we would say, oh my goodness, David is a murderer. He's an adulteress. But he never stopped loving God. And it's very difficult to love God and have all that hatred in your heart. It doesn't really matter what you do. You see, Nathan came to David again, it's a totally different person, and spoke a word and said, David, you know you're dead wrong for not just sleeping with your neighbor's wife, but you also killed him to hide up the fact that she's pregnant. And David could have gotten angry and upset with Nathan and turned on him and said, I dare you talk to me like this. I'm King David. But he doesn't. He is quickened. He is convicted. It's something about his relationship with God that he's able to hear that, and it strikes David's heart. And in Psalms 51, David says this, against you and you only, God, not Nathan, not Bathsheba, not Uriah, her husband, but against you and you only have I done this evil in your sight. And that's how we have to be with God. We have to go to God and say, you know what, God, I got some hurt here. Some things that happened to me disappointed me. And I feel like you just left me out there to dry. Well, how do you think David felt after coming from that pasture and defeating Goliath and having to beg somebody for food? You think he felt like God was really with him? Probably not, but his heart was with him. And his heart was always in the right place. And it's funny because when they're trying to pick Saul, who was actually the king before David, God says this when Samuel is trying to pick the king. You're judging the outward appearance. He looks at all of David's brothers. They're all good-looking guys. They're all statuous. And they're all successful. And they're all in Saul's army. And he says, no, there's one more missing. And David is a little ruddy guy. And God says this to Samuel, you are judging the outward appearance, but I'm judging the heart. And this scripture that I'm reading in the breadth of the Bible, in the 66 books that I read, God cares a lot about your heart, not just your physical heart. He cares about what's in your heart. And the reason he cares about what's in your heart is because you're carrying things in your heart. And just as you carry bitterness, jealousy, resentment, offense, being oversensitive, being temperamental, you carry those things in your heart, you do know that you can carry God's peace in your heart, his love, his light, his forgiveness, his understanding. Isn't it amazing how we want so much understanding from other people, but too often we're not prepared to understand? And David wasn't perfect, but he did have a perfect heart. If you know anything about David, he had a son with that same woman, Bathsheba, named Solomon. Solomon actually was a flawless man in action and in his life. He never committed adultery. He never murdered anyone. He wasn't loud. He was highly intelligent. And what the Word of God says, very, very wise. But he had 300 wives and 700 concubines. And a lot of those wives were foreign wives, wives that God told him not to take. And they didn't cause him to become a murderer or an adulterer or a thief or a vandal or a rapist or a robber or any of those things. They changed his heart towards God. And they caused Solomon to start worshiping other gods. So isn't it amazing how God sees us differently than we see ourselves and even the world sees us? Isn't it amazing that he's more concerned about the climate and the culture and the temperature that's in your heart? Isn't that amazing? Bet you didn't think about that before. Me either. I had to pray and ask God about it. And he said, it's all a heart thing. Whatever's in your heart. And Proverbs, the same King Solomon, says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Be careful what you long for, what you like and what you love, what you let in your heart, what you let out of your heart, what you keep in there too long. The Word of God also says, don't let a seed of bitterness take root. Don't let a seed of bitterness take root. Where? In your heart. Because what's going to happen is going to produce a harvest of hatred, a harvest of resentment, a harvest of bitterness. And what is that going to bring to your life? Not the ultimate plan of God. In John 10:10, it says this, the thief of your soul, he comes to do but three things, to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And then there's a comma, but. And that comma, but, it says this, Jesus Christ has come that you might have life and have life more abundantly. You see, the blood of Jesus trumps bloodline curses. The blood of Jesus trumps sickness that's in our blood and in our systems, spiritually and physically. The blood, it still has its power, and it's the only currency of any value in the spiritual realm. And so if you want to change your life and the outcome and the harvest and the things that are happening to you, ask God to change and transform your heart. I'm not saying that what happened to you isn't real. I'm not saying that you didn't feel the blow of the last trauma or tragedy or thing that happened. It was very real, but it's not more real than the God that I'm telling you about through Jesus Christ. It's not more real than the word that substantiates that truth. Pray and ask God for more than just a house, a spouse, a car, and a career. Ask Him to heal your heart. Ask Him to restore your soul. Ask Him to give you the mind of Christ. Ask Him to let His light shine through your body. And then you, as Paul tells us in Romans 12, submit your body to God, your body, the box, because other things are in there. Submit your body to God as a living, breathing sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto Him. When you can't control life, that's the least you can do is control this and what comes out of you. It's been my pleasure to serve you in faith and fitness. I'll see you guys next time on The Move with Joanna Ward. Take care. We'll be right back.